The rain is gone, yes it has. Because all my hurt feelings have disappeared. And deep inside here, I feel a rainbow. Yes, I do. It's gonna be bright. Oh, bright. A sunshiny day. You know it too. It's gonna be bright. Oh, bright. A sunshiny day.
Sunshiny day, living there in the heart of mankind, in the heart of child kind, in the heart of sister kind, in the heart of brother kind. It is so bright. So bright, a sunshiny day.
I do want to share something with you, though, because it really speaks to, I believe, what I want to talk about today. And that is, I want to share with you what I believe. And this is not like what we believe. There's no oath you have to take to be a member of this center. No creed, no dogma. But I want to share where I'm coming from. I believe in an infinite presence that is knowable and personal, and that presence works through universal laws or principles in an orderly and harmonious way. So there's something that's beyond my description, and yet I can know it personally, and it personally knows me. And when we move into conscious cooperation with these principles, we can change our lives for the better and be a force for good in the world. Like, wow, what a force for good, a force for good in the world. Not just do good stuff. There's a difference between doing good stuff and being a force for good in the world. That's actually one of our statements, our vision statement. Part of our vision statement is to be a force for good in the world. The theme for this month is creativity. I've appreciated being able to talk about that because what I'm becoming awake to is that creativity should be taught in schools. Just why not? We are creative. Why not teach young people how to use that creative principle in us? For everyone that has children and they have them here, they're going to get bits and pieces of that. But wouldn't it be great in school? I mean, wouldn't you have liked to have known what you're just beginning to find out now? I mean, there's some things like, why not teach cooking again? I mean, I wasn't going to take the class anyway, but somebody should have. You know, really. And then, like, manners. And personal finance. And how to invest money. How to play well with others. How to have conversations that are not easy, but important. I mean, we could go on and on. All those things, they're like life skills. And then we bumble along and kind of pick them up all along the way. And by the time I picked them all up, it's like, well, gee. Now all I want to do is be on a beach. So I'm closing out what everything that I could include to get in this thing that I wanted to share with you about creativity, because we are creative. We can't get out of it. We can't turn the switch off. We are creative. We were born that way. We have it in us. Our spiritual DNA made us creative. We don't just push things around. We have the capability to envision something that has never been before and create it. I don't know about whales, but I'm pretty sure that we're the only species so far that we know of that can think of something that's never been before and go, wow, why not? And then be open to all that it would take to make that happen. We're an amazing species. But it's not just the scientists or the engineers or those, you know, visionary thinkers. It's us. And we need to know how to do that. So I've been talking about that. And I'm going to wrap it up today. And the talk title is How Good Can You Stand It? So I will give you the last piece that I know of for creating the life that would make you feel satisfied and fulfilled. And be a force for good in the world. I want to handle all of that today. But first of all, I wanted to say that I want to give you some metaphysical teaching, some teaching that is expounded upon and beyond limits, but I just want to bring everybody up to date because you may have not have taken Beyond Limits. You may have taken it 10 years ago, and now you're going to go, oh, really? I forgot about that. This is so important. Now, what I think is kind of funny, because I've been reading Judge Thomas Troward again, and I think it's kind of funny that Ernest Holmes was inspired by this great metaphysician and dummied it down for human consumption. Now, who's read the textbook? That's dummied down. So it's my job to dummy down, down, how the universe works so that you can work it. Because it's working anyway, but if we don't work with it, We get results that we would not have signed up for, which is kind of what I've been talking about for a while. So the essence of Judge Thomas Troward's work and the essence of Ernest Holmes' work, because he spent so much attention on the law, not later Ernest. What I find interesting is that many of our classes are based on early Ernest. That's like studying early Picasso and thinking that was who he is. But if you saw early Picasso, you would not recognize it as Picasso. What he said at the very end of his life is he wished he had taught more love and less law. But it's good to know the law because it's working anyway. So the essence of all, you know, if I could just scrunch it all together, it has to do with the law of cause and effect. And the law of cause and effect is taught in some way, shape, or form in every religious or spiritual tradition. We cannot escape it. It's taught. It's taught in Hinduism. Dharma is taught in Buddhism. How many of you read Autobiography of a Yogi by Yogananda? Great. So you remember when he was touched by his guru and his consciousness expanded and it went beyond his body, and then he wasn't in his body, and then he wasn't in the ashram, and then he wasn't in the town, and then he wasn't even on earth, because consciousness has no confines, and he was being connected to the one consciousness, and he was, which is just pure awareness, and he's just pure awareness out in all of space. And he says, and there at the very center of the universe is the law of cause and effect. Most of what we hear about and learn about in metaphysics or New Thought teachings or just personal growth is about the law of cause and effect. But a lot of attention is put on certain aspects of that law, like the law of attraction. A lot of attention on the law of attraction. I will tell you why that doesn't work in just a moment, why it doesn't work as well in just a moment. Because the law of attraction says that you will draw to you what you expect. So if you have a vision board and you look at something a lot, you're going to start to have that in your consciousness, and you might even expect it. If you do a lot of affirmations, you will have that in your consciousness and you might even expect it. But when it doesn't work is when you see it, but you don't really expect it. You want it, you hope for it, but you don't really expect it. Attraction is based on expectation, not wishful thinking. Not even declaring. It's based on expectation. Another word for that in the Bible would be faith. You can believe something but not have faith in it. How many of you know that you've watched yourself do that? Be real self-aware. I believe it, but you don't have faith. There's no expectation yet. And it's expectation that activates the law of attraction. Can we go over a tiny bit? Because I was just thinking about my first vision board. And I was in my 20s. I look back, I wish I had that body. I grew up never being happy with it, so of course, I was smoking hot and not happy with it. So I had this picture of this fabulous body that I wanted to have. And I put it on a vision board, along with all sorts of other things, including a man that wasn't my husband, who turned out, anyway. More to be revealed. Or not. But one day I'm on vacation and I look down and what I have is the swimming suit of what was in my vision board. And this is a weird swimming suit. It's not like a normal, this was weird. Somehow out of nowhere, I attracted that swimming suit. Not the body, but the swimming suit. Since I had the expectation that I was never going to be good enough, even if I had the body, I couldn't have seen it. Which leads me to the next thing. This is what we really should be teaching, and not so much the law of attraction, but the law of mental equivalence. I'm not sure if there's one downstairs, but there used to be in our bookstore a little booklet called Mental Equivalence. It's the everything. And basically what that says is that you will always have as much good as you can stand. And what is normal is yours. See, if it wasn't normal for me to appreciate my body, I was not going to be able to get there. Even if I had it. What can happen with attraction is that you can generate it enough and have it, but it's fleeting. Because the internal experience, the mental equivalent, what is inside of you, that feeling nature in you, doesn't hold it. It's like flybys. How many of you have had those? You have this intention, you pray for it, you put a ministry of prayer request in, and it gets very close, but then it passes through. It's because there's no mental equivalent. It's not normal to have the thing. We must use our creative abilities to create a new normal so that you are the person who would naturally have the thing that you wanted to attract. This is a big teaching in Beyond Limits. Oftentimes we want stuff or actions or circumstances to create an experience, but true metaphysics is about creating the experience and then everything else follows. That's why in the Bible it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven and all else is given. Now, kingdom in that time was a realm. It was a realm. And it was a realm of power. That's where the power lay. So seek that realm of power, which is heaven, and all else shall be added unto you. So seek the, and heaven is an inner state, the kingdom of heaven is within you, is that inner state of being happy, fulfilled, content, peaceful, secure, right with the world, worthy, appreciated, whatever it is, that realm lies within. And when we seek that inner experience, everything else shows up to reflect that. One of the highest spiritual principles or practices, I would say, is the practice of leaping from one experience, internal experience, to another. And it is not for the faint of heart. And it's not for the person that wants to just be fixed. It's for someone who says, I would rather have heaven than be right about how justified I am in being whatever you're being. Internal experience without, you have to seek an internal experience without outer confirmation. That's not always easy. Einstein said that we can never solve a problem at the level of the problem. Well, you can never shift your life at the level of vibration that you're at right now. We have to raise above in vibration. We have to raise above in our own internal experience, and then all else is raised up with us. Let me give you an illustration. I've got two to share with you. But let's talk about somebody else first. There's a gentleman that I've known for a very long time. And for a very long time, he was on the edge financially. Yeah, he paid for things, but it was slow. And yeah, he could pay his rent, but barely. And yeah, he could kind of have a good life. And he'd see hints. He'd pray. He's been in this movement for a long time. I need to get close to something, and it would back away. He'd do a job, and they wouldn't pay him. They ran out of money. He wasn't getting the recognition. It was like, I've got all this skill, and it's sort of like on the fringes. How many of you know someone that's always on the fringe of a breakthrough? For years, I've known him. He's on the fringe of a breakthrough. Just close but no cigar or paycheck. I'd rather have the paycheck. Some of you would rather have the cigar. I don't know. Well, he's been doing a lot of inner work, and he's finally got it. He's finally got that it's an internal experience, that he had to change his internal experience. And what he got was that his internal experience, his mental equivalent, what was normal was struggle. What was normal for him was financial struggle. Even when he made it, it was a struggle. He always made it, but it was a struggle. And he thought, oh, that's me. That's my vibration. That's my frequency. He didn't use those words, but he's like, that's my mental equivalent. So, and then I have to say, the most profound thing that you can ever have right before the big breakthrough is to recognize how you contributed. And when he got that this is what I'm used to, he then, because he had the tools, he created a new experience. I mean, he had to make it out of nothing. He had to use his intelligence, his creativity, his ability to vision, his ability to imagine, and imagine himself in a totally new life where everything came to him easily. He had to like not wait for it to get there and not say, but I don't know how that feels. We didn't know what it was like to be on the moon either. If we base our life on our past, how many of you want to sign up for that? I don't want to live in this country if we continue on our trajectory. I want a whole new country. But I can't have a whole new country if I can't have a whole new Kathianne. So we have to be able to use all of those things. We were given everything at birth. So he imagined and began to feel everything taken care of before he needed it. And I saw him last week and he said, you know what? I don't have struggle anymore. I just gave up struggle. I don't have that. It's not in here. No struggle. He got three jobs, and two of them paid him ahead of time. There's no more struggle. Seek ye first that kingdom of sufficiency, that kingdom of support, that kingdom of worthiness, and all else shall be added. And sometimes it's not easy. I had a not easy time last week. Something showed up in my personal life, and it was not easy. It was being recorded, and I'm not saying nothing. But that's why you come to first service, then you get the juicy details. But for the rest of you, I just want to say, I knew who I wanted to be, and I couldn't be that. I knew I wanted to be at peace, and I wasn't. I knew what I was capable of, but I couldn't get there. So I sent out a prayer request to all of our prayer practitioners. See, you don't have to do this alone. I didn't tell them what was going on. I just said, pray for this. And I got lifted up by people who didn't know my backstory or care. And there was a part of me that said, I can't be peaceful because of that backstory. I should really just tell them all the details. Then even they would believe that I can't have peace. That'll get me nowhere, but I'll be right. We all do that, don't we? Yes. you know, unless you're all saints, I don't know why this room can't hold you all for prayers after the services. I don't know why the practitioners are not here till 5 o'clock at night praying for everybody. Tonight, I tell you, I don't like pain. I don't sign up for pain. If somebody can pray it away, whether it's mental or spiritual or physical, I'm all in. Give it to them. You do the work. And as it turned out, they did. And what was so cool is I felt peaceful. And very recently, I got this sweet note that said that something had shifted on the outside. I got that this morning and I went, "My God is an awesome God. It rains." That prayer shit works. Said we should be the prayingest people on the planet because we believe it works. And if we believe it's working and you can't do it yourself, why wouldn't you let somebody else pray for you? And there'll be times you are stuck. I was stuck of a very low vibration. And I, of myself, wasn't able to pull myself up, but I know how to get pulled up. That's what we're here for in community. We all hurt at times, and we can all be lifted at times. So, this is important in doing our part to continually prove prayer to ourselves. But it's also important so that we can then know that we have the power to create a better world and that we can be a force for good in the world. Because a lot of people look out, not you, of course, but a lot of people look out into the world and see all that is wrong and they vibrate at what's wrong. If you say it's wrong, you vibrate at what's wrong. There is another way, which is to be lifted up and see what can be done and then vibrate there. Not what's wrong, but what can be done. I mean, I loved it that I put stuff on Facebook. Like me on Facebook. I find the best stuff. That people in Kenya who had no materials to build boats out of, they're building them out of the plastic they find in the ocean and old flip-flops. And they're building these great boats. Someone else found a way to take plastic and turn it into a fuel for cars. See, if we look at this, and I'm all over this plastic stuff in a bad way, but somebody's vibrating at what could we do, and to them the solutions happen. Yesterday I was amazed and so thrilled to be reading once again this thing called You. This is my old copy, and Ernest Holmes is so clear in this book and also has these great meditations. And listen to this. My mind is open to new ideas. My spirit is ever active in me and the divine mind is inexhaustible. There's no weary or monotonous actions in spirit. It is forever new and vibrant and fresh with ideas. I know that I'm continually receiving new impressions of life, new, better, and fuller ways of living. I let the newness, the freshness, the originality of spirit permeate my entire consciousness. So if you're doing same old, same old, read this over and over again. But do you see how this is powerful for us as a culture? Because there's always a solution. Who's listening? But we don't listen. So we do it from two levels. We listen for the personal and we listen for the universal. See, the universal becomes personal to us. Like, I don't know how to get out of this. New ideas. And the other one is, I want to be a force for good in the world. new ideas. Let's just take a deep breath. And who's up for being just a little bit over? Okay. I'd love for you to have a feeling and have the collective energy of a group of people, because where two or more are gathered in the name of the I Am, and you are that I Am, something amazing can happen. That won't happen, I'm sorry, by yourself. So have a group of people if you're going to watch from now on. No, really, group consciousness, if you noticed, all the holy people had group consciousness. So you use group consciousness. So we're just group consciousness for waking up and doing things together. So how many of you have something that's a burden? Like, and it's just, well, you're coping with it. It's the same old, same old, same old. Great. Okay, so go inside, take a deep breath. We're going to see if we can do some chemicalization. I mean transformation, and also shift the body. So take a deep breath and let yourself feel that burden. And then feel it and see if you can put a word to that burden. My friend discovered that when he thought of money, he thought of struggle. In the midst of this burden, this thing you've been handling, this thing that you've been putting up with, what is the word that's in the middle of it? What is your mental equivalent? Take a deep breath. And now I speak my word that the Holy Spirit is moving in through and as each and every person here, and switching, moving, transforming that inner experience into something with a higher vibration. It is the absolute saving grace of God. So for what once was struggle, there's now sufficiency. For what was once loneliness, there is now love and connection. So when you know what your new normal, what you want is your new normal, raise your hand. When you know what was and what you want now, just raise your hand. Great. Now take a deep breath. And let's just, in some way, shape, or form, gently press your body to your body. Like you might press your hands together. You might press your hands on your heart. You might press your hands on your shoulder. You might press your hands into your legs as you're sitting. But I want you to just breathe, and not only just breathe into your lungs and breathe into this new idea, but I want you to breathe it into your whole body so that you are embodying this new idea. And I speak my word that this is the beginning of a new mental equivalent. This is the idea of a new normal. This is an expansion of awareness of good. And I say, thank you, sweet spirit, that this can happen. Thank you, sweet spirit, that this can happen. And for each and every one of you that truly wants to have this shift, say within your heart of hearts, I accept this shift. I accept this new idea.
I accept this new idea.
Living in me.
Living in me.
And as the cause of a new life experience.
As the cause of a new life experience.
I will not make anything happen.
I will not make anything happen.
For God will do the work.
For God will do the work.
And so it is. And when we say God, it's really the law of cause and effect. To accept a new mental equivalent is to accept a new cause. Therefore, await, as Ernest Holmes said, await with glad expectation the unfoldment of this prayer, the new effect. So, first service, I asked them, And I'm just going to, you know, sort of speed right along here. I asked them what they see in the world, in our outer world, that we could shift and change so that we don't add to the vibration. Because if I see a problem and I make it a big deal in my mind, I add energy to that issue. And one of them stood up and said what they noticed a lot lately is division. Who would like to agree with, I mean, not agree with it, but how many of you would say that you've been seeing some division lately? So what is the opposite of division?
Unity.
Unity and?
Oneness.
Fabulous. I love a good practitioner. Oneness. See, division can't be true in God because God's one and God's everything. But we've believed in it, and therefore we get the effects of what we believed in as a culture. And then when we see it and we don't like it, it just gets worse. How many of you have noticed it's getting worse? So my call, if we're going to be a force for good, is yes, we reach out, and yes, we vote, and yes, we do what we're called to do, and yes, we build houses for Habitat, and yes, we feed people. But another way to do it as a spiritual community is to look at a spiritual level, at the level of oneness, so that we become the epicenter of vibration that will draw people who are attracted to that idea. So we, like in a way, we become a practitioner to our city. Just as I was lifted up, people won't know it, but they'll be lifted up. So I'd love for you to, and there's another word for oneness, and it's love. What you really love, you feel one with. It's too bad that love has been so dummied down. So, you know, love the bagel. Love the meal, love the weather. But, and I have felt one with bagels before, but still, it's not something I choose to do. But to love something in a sense of I'm one with it is a totally different thing. And it is the antidote to this division. So I'd love for you to join me in a prayer. And I actually feel one with this. Ernest Holmes said it's not what we pray to or what we pray about, but where we pray from that is most important. And I was just given a quote by Richard Snyder, who was quoting one of the great rabbis of the world, and he said basically the same thing. So Ernest, Rabbi, Rabbi Ernest, it's all the same thing. We're going to shift where we're praying from, and then we'll do the prayer. So to do that, I'd love for you to close your eyes if you choose. Join me in recalling and bringing to mind and to heart someone you truly love or something you truly love. It could be a person, it could be the earth, it could be a pet, it could be a memory, it could have been a time when your heart was so open and you felt so at one with something. The first time you held the baby, the time you held your parents' hand, the time someone reached out to you and gave you just the encouragement you needed. Breathe into that memory and put it in your heart. And breathe into your heart now with a deep, deep breath. And let that memory expand and expand. For if you've ever loved, you always loved. And if you can ever love, you'll always love. It did not go away, it's still present. We're just drawing our attention to it. And when you feel that love in your heart, and you're willing to let it escape your body and to flow out into the room, simply raise your hand. Let it flow out into the room. Let the love be generated and expanded. And from this place of love, from this place of cooperative, connected love, I speak my word that this center is an epicenter for connection, for unity, for oneness, and for love. And I speak my word that the Holy Spirit that knows all things is now allowing this vibration to touch people who need that right now. The Holy Spirit is allowing this vibration, this consciousness, to lift up people who need that right now. I give thanks that the Holy Spirit is doing a great and marvelous work and allowing this vibration to go out and encourage and inspire and renew people who need that right now. I give thanks that if the Bible can say that the weapons will be put down and people will be remembering their unity with other people, let it be right now. I give thanks that our politicians are being inspired on how to work together right now. I give thanks that there is an energy moving out from us where we are finding solutions to everything that the United States faces right now. That solutions are the modality that we live from in this congregation, in our lives, collectively, individually, personally, and we are affirming that for our country right now. For our God is an awesome God. And we do not do the work, we just hold the vision. We hold the consciousness. We hold the vibration. We hold the future. And so it is.
The taste of salt, the dance of waves, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. A lightning flash, my pounding heart, a breaching wave, a shooting star gives testimony that you are, and my soul wells up with hallelujahs. Oh, praise now all these mighty works. There is no language where you can't be heard. Your song goes out to all the earth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, crater moon and sparrow's wings, oh, thunder's boom and Saturn's rings, unveil the Creator as we sing, and my soul wells up with hallelujah. Mighty works. There is no language. the earth. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Falling snow, a rising mist. There is no higher praise than this, and each soul wells up. Every soul. Oh.